This meeting is being recorded.
Good morning. This is the Clay Terrace Bible Study. We will be in Isaiah 29 this morning. We've talked about a few prayer requests, and Holly has agreed to pray us in.
All right, let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, thank you for loving us, adoring us, and showing us the way of truth through Jesus Christ. And the life in him never ends. So open our eyes, enlighten them with your wisdom and the inner man, so that our whole life will be full of the light of Christ, and that we will rejoice in him and walk with him all the days of our lives. Bless our families and their finances. Bless our family's health. And may all of our families know you, Lord, through Christ. And we thank you for this study and pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, well, we will start the reading again, Isaiah 29, starting in verse 15. Isaiah says, "Woe to those who go to great depths to hide their plans from the Lord, who do their work in darkness and think, 'Who sees us? Who will know?' You turn things upside down as if the potter were thought to be like the clay. Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, 'You didn't make us'? And the potter say to the potter, 'You know nothing.' In a very short time, will not Lebanon be turned into a fertile field, and the fertile field seem like a forest? In that day, the deaf will hear the words of the scroll, and out of gloom and darkness, the eyes of the blind will see.
The humble also shall increase their joy in the Lord, and the poor among men shall rejoice in the Holy One of Israel. For the terrible one is brought to nothing. The scornful one is consumed, and all who watch for iniquity are cut off. Who make a man an offender by a word, and lay a snare for him who reproves the gate, and turn aside the just by empty words.
Therefore, thus says the Lord, who redeemed Abraham concerning the house of Jacob. Jacob shall no more be ashamed, no more shall his face grow pale. For when he sees his children, the work of my hands in his midst, they will sanctify my name. They will sanctify the Holy One of Jacob, and will stand in awe of the God of Israel. And those who go astray in the spirit will come to understanding, and those who murmur will accept instruction." Well, we find ourselves here in verses 15 through 24 in the 29th chapter of Isaiah. And when we look at verses 15 and 16, you who hide deep from the Lord your counsel, whose deeds are in the dark, and who said, "Who sees us? Who knows us?" You turn things upside down. Shall the potter be regarded as the clay, that the thing made should say to its maker, "He did not make me"? Or the thing formed say of him who formed it, "He has no understanding"? We see here that rather than having a demonstration of forthrightness and openness that would be inspired by their trust in God, we see the leaders of Judah reduced to secrecy and dealing with underhanded human politics. For them, the sovereignty of our God might not or should not even exist. I want you to turn to Jeremiah, I think it's 18. Yeah, Jeremiah 18 for just a moment. Jeremiah 18, 1 through 12. Jeremiah 18, 1 through 12. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words. So we see here that Jeremiah is being told from the Lord to go down to the potter's house. He's going to give him an object lesson here. Look at verse 3. So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. And the vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand. And he reworked it into another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to do. Then the word of the Lord came to me, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter has done, declares the Lord. Behold, like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. So we see here that the lesson is showing that it is God who is sovereign, that God who has the ability to rework the pottery in his hand when it has spoiled and gone another way and not done exactly as he has prescribed to it. Pick it up at verse 6 here, or rather verse 7. If at any time I declare concerning a nation or kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy, and if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will relent of the disaster that I intended to do to it. And if at any time I declare concerning a nation or kingdom that I will build and plant it, and if that nation does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will relent of the good that I have intended to do. Now, therefore, say to the man of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, behold, I am shaping disaster against you and devising a plan against you. Stop right there. Isn't that an incredible frightening statement that the Lord thy God, the sovereign Lord, says, I'm shaping disaster against you and devising a plan against you. And then he reaches out one more time when he says, return everyone from his evil way and amend your ways and your deeds. But they say, that is in vain. We will follow our own plans and we will act accordingly to the stubbornness of his evil heart. So we see a similar situation happening here, that the Lord's reaching out to them, telling them that, you know, they cannot say they have no understanding when the one that has created them, they're just caught up in their unbelief here. Look at verses 17 through 21. Is it not yet a very little while until Lebanon shall be turned into a fruitful field, and the fruitful field shall be regarded as a forest? In that day, the deaf shall hear the words of the book, and out of their gloom and darkness, the eyes of the blind shall see. The meek shall obtain fresh joy in the Lord, and the poor among mankind shall exalt the Holy One of Israel. For the ruthless shall come to nothing, and the scoffer cease, and all who watch to do evil shall be cut off. Who by a word make a man out to be an offender, and lay a snare for him who reproves in the gate, and with an empty plea turns aside him who is right. So here we see the people of Judah and the leaders, despite their unbelief, God is promising to transform the moral order here, that he is going to establish the very gospel of Christ and accomplish this transformation even in their unbelief and even in their disobedience. Look at them, Isaiah 61, 1 through 3 should do it. Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 3. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant to those who mourn in Zion, to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit, that they may be called the oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. So we see here that the Spirit of the Lord, there are going to be here, this phrase, the Spirit of the Lord, kind of looks back at Isaiah, 48:16, that says, draw near to me, hear this. From the beginning, I have not spoken in secret. From the time it came to be, I have been there. And now the Lord God has sent me and his Spirit. Now, in Isaiah 48, this is still somewhat an unidentified speaker, but we see, you know, if you were to continue down to Isaiah 49, 1 through 6, we will see the picture clearer, and that the person that is unidentified in chapter 48 is identified in 49 as a servant of the Lord. This is unlike, you know, Cyrus, that the servant's power was a human sword, but here it's a divine spirit. So we recognize that this reference here in Isaiah 48:16 is a reference to the Trinity. The Father, the Lord God, the Son has sent me, and the Holy Spirit, his Spirit. And when we go back to chapter 61 and look at verses 1 through 3, we recognize that the messianic speaker here, servant, is Christ himself, who's going to create a new people by his Spirit and by the Spirit of his empowered preaching. Isaiah says the goal here is a sevenfold goal. Really, you have what you call the seven purpose clauses here, starting with the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And then he speaks about the poor. Matthew 5 and 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, when here Matthew speaks of being blessed, he's talking more than just a temporary circumstance of feeling happy. Being blessed here in the Beatitudes is a state of well-being because of our relationship with God. And this feeling of being blessed belongs to those who have responded to Jesus' ministry. Matthew tells us that the poor in the spirit here are those who recognize without a doubt that they need God's help. And because they need God's help, God gives it to them, and they recognize that theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And it belongs to them because they have, in their weakness and their humility, confessed that they are spiritually bankrupt. And others who think that they can depend upon themselves, depend on themselves. When we go back to Isaiah 61 again, looking at these other purpose clauses here, speaks about to proclaim liberty. That's Leviticus 25 and 10. And you shall consecrate the 15th year and proclaim, the 50th year, and proclaim liberty throughout the land to all of its inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee for you. when each of you shall return to his property, and each of you shall return to his clan. Now we recognize that here, the whole idea of this jubilee, you know, goes back to the Day of Atonement to announce the beginning of the 50th year. Jubilee was the release of that liberty. And in that year, people are to return to their land possession, their ancestral property. Israelites that have been sold into indentured slavery were also to be released and sent home. And this provided a restoration for the means of earning a living in an Egarian society. But again, the Jubilee did not give all the possessions to those in Israel back. You know, they didn't trade the cattle back or the money wasn't relocated. But there were prohibitions during the Jubilee, just like it would be in the sabbatical year, that, you know, you would not be able to work the land for those 2 years here. I think the 49th and the 50th year, you wouldn't be able to work the land to allow the land to restore itself. So you would have to leave the land fallow during that time. Going back to Isaiah 61, 1 through 3, speaks of the opening of the prison. So that's a return from Babylonian exile and the spirit of freedom from those who have oppressed, really the oppression of sin and the oppression of Satan. The year of the Lord's favor, which we see in Isaiah 63 and 4. For the day of vengeance was in my heart, and my year of redemption had come. So we recognize here that the day of vengeance, again, and the year of redemption goes back to this time where Isaiah is speaking of it in 61, 1 through 3. As he takes us through these purpose clauses. Then we look at, there's a quote that comes out of, I think it's Luke. Luke 4, 18 through 19. Luke 4, 18 through 19. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering the sight of the blind.
Is that hey, Andy.
Liberty? Yes.
Andy. Hey, just all this added together, you know, as we started in the early part of Isaiah 29, talking about the injustice and then talking about, hey, things are going to turn around in a redemptive sense. And then we start reading this, hey, I'm, as you said, from Isaiah 61, proclaiming good news to the poor. I'm like, so immediately I'm thinking of folks who say, oh, well, the gospel is only death, burial, resurrection. Boy, that doesn't seem to match up. What happened to good news to the poor? What happened to setting prisoners free? What happened to the turnaround redemption? This passage certainly seems to indicate the good news is way more than just the last, you know, few chapters of each of the Gospels. What do you say?
I would say absolutely. I think it is still ongoing. It's one of those not yet prophecies here, but it includes. And this is where, you know, we sometimes break off in Reformed theology. It includes social justice. When he talks about healing the sight of the blind, he's talking about physical and spiritual. And when he talks about liberty for those who are oppressed, he's talking about the healing of the sick, casting out demons, forgiving sins, the ethical teachings of Jesus that promote social justice. You can't separate social justice from the teachings of Jesus.
Amen. I remember the angels. The angels appeared apparently over the shepherd's flock, right? Appeared first to them and said, "You're going to bring good news, for unto you is born this day." I'm like, wait a minute. Didn't good news at the very least start that day? Anyway, so yeah, I guess it's a rant, but people narrow the gospel down as if Jesus wasn't incarnated among us and went through the trials that we go through and temptations and so forth and overcomes. So, okay, sorry. Thanks for thanks for indulging my interruption.
You're talking about...
will not be held accountable for what the gospel requires.
Yeah, hey, Holly's got a question or a comment.
A comment, you know, that God will judge everything. And our social actions are just part of it. But, you know, I think his judgment is so complete and knowing and good that I always say it's just justice, not social justice. That's kind of a little, that's the way I see it.
Well, if
we have made a negative, social justice a negative term. And probably added, you know, we've added a different outlook toward that. But I mean, again, a cursory reading of the Old Testament will back up and undergird our understanding of what social justice means and how, again, he wants everyone to be provided for. Now, whether or not, you know, how that works out, again, if it works out with those who are the people of God, that we see started in Acts. And I think even in those who came and were won over by the gospel in the Old Testament, how they reacted to one another. And making sure, you know, beg pardon?
Well, I was just going to say, absolutely. And we know Jesus rolled up the whole thing for us and said, this isn't that hard. You know, love God with all your heart, soul, everything, and love your neighbors yourself. So if social justice is denigrated, then you're denigrating, you know, the second aspect of the royal law. So you know, we have to take scripture in entirety. We can't simply take one verse out of Corinthians, which is vitally important. I get it. You know, it says it's of first importance or something. The culmination of the gospel was, yes, he died on the cross and paid the price for our sins to free us, to totally free the captives. But that's just the ultimate culmination, punctuation, whatever you will, of the gospel. It is not the entire gospel.
Well, I agree with you, Neil. That healing is in, you know, and that it comes in many forms, and those that preach that sometimes get persecuted. I was, you know, so there still is persecution with the gospel. If you're really preaching things, and I'm sorry, I have to comment. I still see social as being relating man to man. That's why I like justice instead of social justice, because so many people think that justice is going to come by man instead of by God. And when you put social in there, that's the way I see it.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Holly, the reason they call it social is because it is, you know, on the lateral level. But man needs to love man's neighbor as himself. So, yeah, all acts of justice have to be social. I mean, what act of justice can you do that isn't social?
I
realize
I disagree,
people denigrate the term.
I'm just going to say I disagree and leave it there.
Okay, fair enough. Andy, back to you.
Yeah, I can see where Holly's talking about, but it's It's God's justice done in society.
Okay, I can go definitely go with that. Yeah,
Yeah, it's
definitely.
God's justice done in society.
Yeah, because, but I mean, the whole earth is going to be redeemed. It's not going to be just man. It includes the earth groans. It actually groans. So there's redemption of earth and the animal life and everything. So
Is that the environmental justice?
no, because I think when you say environmental justice, they put man in there and they're not thinking about God's redemption of it. That's my opinion.
Amen. Let's pick it back
So,
up
hey,
then.
Andy.
Yeah.
Andy, so in Isaiah 29, as this is moving forward, and especially that allusion to Isaiah 61, where it talks about, hey, the Lord's appointed me to proclaim good news, and we know that's messianic prophecy of the incarnated Jesus, right?
Right.
But then some of these other phrases to declare vengeance of our God, the comfort, da, da, da. So as it goes on, it seems more to be talking about the end state when God's going to judge things. So where does Isaiah 29 fall in that timeline? Is it eschatological, I guess, is the question.
And I'm gonna always default to the fact that it's eschatological, because we can see just in our human sight that it has not happened yet, and that is working toward that. And the dimension of that, whether it is calling for the gospel reaching everyone, universally on the earth, and or is it reaching those that God, who have assigned their faith to Jesus Christ, our Lord, to God the Father and God the Holy Spirit? Is it, I don't want to say limited, but is it just speaking of that particular God's culture, those who have trusted the Lord? But it's definitely future.
Okay, thanks.
Because I don't, we're not, I mean, we, I, it's hard to find a time when we look at Judah and Jerusalem that they hit that point. And I, have we ever hit that point here?
Yeah,
Are we still in the throes of it? I mean, when we look at 22 through 24, just look at some of the language here. Therefore, thus says the Lord, who redeemed Abraham concerning the house of Jacob. Jacob shall no more be ashamed, no more shall his face grow pale. For when he sees his children, the work of my hands in his midst, they will sanctify my name. They will sanctify the Holy One of Jacob, and will stand in awe of the God of Israel. And to those who go astray in the spirit will come to understanding, and those who murmur will accept instruction. So I see here that despite our failures, despite Judah's failures and the failures of their leaders, God is still a God, still going to keep his promises that he's made to the descendants of Abraham, who themselves need redemption. I think we see that, back in Joshua 24, 1 through 3. Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel. And they presented themselves before the Lord. And Joshua said to the people, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your fathers lived beyond the Euphrates, Terah, the father of Abraham and Nahor, and they served other gods. Then I took your father Abraham beyond the river and led him through the land of Canaan and made his offspring many. I gave him Isaac. So we recognize that, again, the fact that it says, thus says the Lord, kind of sets up Joshua as his status as the true successor to Moses. And that, again, this comes in the end times when we finally get to that part that we are able to see the whole plan in its fulfillment, that God brings it to fruition, that the fruitfulness is shown through the awe that we have for the Lord thy God, and he will replace the openness and the hope to the troubled church. And, you know, the church is troubled right now in our different understandings of what God requires of us and what he's, how he's going to hold us accountable. And are we operating in the fullness that he's called us to do? Again, anytime man gets in anything and man starts to set the parameters, you better believe we're gonna just like in with the Jews, we're gonna miss a lot of what God is asking us to when we start making it commandments of man and not commandments that came from the Lord.
Well, the whole discussion of fruitfulness reminds me of earlier in Isaiah, where it talked about the vineyard, and then we read later in Matthew 21. Jesus giving the parable of the vineyard and saying, hey, this, you know, y'all weren't doing the vineyard right, and you weren't turning the fruits over to the owner and so forth. And I'm going to put this vineyard in the hands of a new set of folks who are going to produce good fruits, and they are going to turn over those fruits to the Lord. So, you know, and certainly I would see that as the church, New Testament church, that is. I realize we have our foibles, and we could be a whole lot more fruitful than we are, but there's a whole lot more fruit than there were back in the days when there were only, a handful of people in a little tiny territory in the Middle East who knew the Lord particularly well, right? And now, right, you know, there are believers all over the world. And they are producing good fruits. Many of these things, whether you call them social justice or you just call them justice, producing good fruits. It's kind of the already not yet. That is, it's inaugurated. It started producing fruits. We just seem to have a long way to go. And God's going to culminate it in a moment, in the, you know, twinkling of an eye. That he will bring about his will, or at least that's the way I read that. Well, Andy, hey, tell me about verse 24, the very last verse in this chapter, in 29. At least my NIV says, those who are wayward in spirit will gain understanding. Those who complain will accept instruction. Who's that talking about? And where on the timeline?
I know it sounds like an excuse, but I have to default again to the end times, that they're still, those who come are delivered from unbelief. Yours says, okay. You got NIV and it says wayward spirit.
Yeah, those who are wayward in spirit will gain understanding. So you're saying that's conversion?
I would see that as conversion, yes.
Okay, all right. And those who complain?
Those who complain will now accept instruction.
Those who push back on the good news will accept the good news.
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Well, hey, is this a good point to ask? How do we apply this today? It's Friday at Clay Terrace, right? This is the real world that we're talking about now. So how can I take Isaiah's prophecies and apply it well? Holly, you look like you've got a thought.
Yeah. No matter how man turns away from God, today I feel we're wanting to deny in government and education, and that God even made us, that God is even there. They want to hide, they want to run from God, they want to deceive people. That's the way I see society now. And despite all this evil, whether it's on purpose, they're deceived. I mean, whether it's like they're deceived, they don't know. Eve was deceived by the devil. She didn't know she was making a mistake, where Adam just bluntly just went with the evil. You know, what, no matter which cause, God is still going to bring it back. And it's not going to be, though we get to share the good news and we get to do all this, it's not going to be us that does it. We are too fallen short. He will bring, miraculously, he will bring back to understanding in verse 24. All those who erred in spirit will come to understanding that it doesn't depend on man. There's nothing social about it. It doesn't depend on, it only depends upon God, who has done it. And he reveals, like, you silly people who thought I didn't make you, all of a sudden they'll see it. And it's miraculous. That's what it
is. Amen.
So even though things look very dark now, because there's a lot of deception and a lot of deceiving going on, that he's going to bring it around. And it's not really dependent. I mean, we get to share the gospel and all that, but it's not going to be dependent upon us. It's him. Yes.
Well, I do like the verse, and you'll have to tell us where it's at. Somewhere in Corinthians, I think, that Paul says that effectively we're God's ambassadors, as if God is making his appeal through us. So we are absolutely involved. But again, it's God working through us, as you said. And the Holy Spirit changes hearts. Neil has never changed a heart.
Mm-hmm.
We don't even change our own heart, right? It is the Spirit that works in us, but to will and to act according to his good purpose.
Amen.
Well, Andy, any last words? excuse me. Let me see if Chaplain Neff has any comments. We'd give him a chance to have the last word. Seeing none, Andy, you want to have the last word and pray us out?
Can you hear me?
Oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. The chaplain's coming on here. Here we go.
Sorry. Regarding the way to apply social justice, I think it's a human effort, as Holly says, and it will always have a standard that is very below God's standard. So it will be always convenient. So many evangelistic efforts that include social justice are conditioned by listening to the gospel. They say, I give you food if you sit down and hear my preaching. I give you clothing if you come to our church and be part of it. It's conditioned by the people, by the denomination of the church. And I think that is selling, in a way, the gospel. And so as we are called to do justice, we ought to be careful not to make it dirty with our own self-ambition and personal convenience. So I just bring that up as we apply it to our Carmel Clay Terrace environment. How can we do it? But it is a good question, the method. but make sure that we avoid falling into the trap of social pressure of you do. It is me who's doing it. It's me who getting the credit. And you need to be thankful. It is not about that. It is actually a given gift of grace the way we have received it. That's my point. Thank you.
Amen. Hey, can you pray for us in any language?
Amen. Father, thank you. Father, muchas gracias. Thank you so much for this wonderful time of being together, reading your word and studying it. I appreciate the effort of Pastor Andy preparing and Neil and Holly being here. Pray for those who are part of our group and they're not here for their personal reasons, that you bless them too. And ask you that you allow us to apply in our life this message of justice you invite us to in ways that you want us to do it. Don't let us get lost, especially with pride in our hearts, to do something that is just works, external works and efforts like the Pharisees. And we miss you as you were walking among them. We might miss you because we are more focused in our own holiness and our own justice effort. I pray for that ability, Lord, to be sensitive and aware of where you are and how you're moving and how you've been our God in the midst of our current history. In your name, I pray these things. Bless this nation. Bless our churches and our families. Please allow us to see you work in our lives in a practical ways, efficient and effective manners that you can do through the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray in his name. We pray this in your name, O Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.